What is up, my Squirtleites? It is I, your king, and welcome back to another episode of Quick Reviews. I'm going to keep trying with this format since it seems to be actually working pretty well, but I feel like I kept things a little too brief in the first episode, so I'll try to say a bit more about each game this time so as not to gloss over any important points. That said, we're still just hurrying this along, and before I jump into the first game, here's a refresher on my grading system. As I said, I grade games on a pretty even system from 1 to 10, so if I rate something a 6, that actually means I thought it was good, so don't get too mad at me if the score is lower than what you're used to on Metacritic. With that said, let's begin. The fourth game I finished in 2021 was Pokemon Platinum for the Nintendo DS. This is the first game I included into my backlog that I've actually completed before in the past, but of all the games in the main series, Diamond, Pearl, and Platinum are the games I have easily the least experience with. The chips just kind of fell into place, and for the most part, Generation 4 was the one I kinda skipped over, even though I was heavily sucked into both Generations 3 and 5. So, due to that lack of nostalgia, and also my preconceived biases with games I'm more familiar with, I've always had sort of a lower opinion of the Sinnoh games. It's not that I thought they were bad, but to me they were one of the weakest, so I figured it's only fair I give them one more fair shake before I solidified my opinion. And, yeah, I'm glad I did, because it's a bit better than I thought. Now, for what it's worth, the two biggest issues that I had with Pokemon Platinum are absolutely still a problem, but there are a few key things that make up for those very same issues. My absolute favorite thing about Pokemon Platinum is actually the level of challenge this game provides. Now, obviously, I'm not saying this game is hard by any means, but as far as Pokemon as a series is concerned, I think it's the most difficult. I'm usually the type of guy to never ever skip a fight so as to keep at the level required as I go, but with this game, I constantly found myself underleveled and actually having to plan accordingly as I went. Granted, I tend to use a full team of 6, which is objectively a handicap compared to smaller teams, but I've never been given this much trouble before. I didn't ever lose my whole team per se, but it was nice to actually think about what I was doing as I went through the game, which as far as Pokemon is concerned is actually kind of a big deal. That's not the only praise I have for Platinum either. Generation 4 is also home to some of the best additions to the Pokedex that really makes team building a blast, despite having less than the generations that both preceded and followed it. Sinnoh's home to a lot of my favorites, such as Floatzel, Glaceon, Garchomp, Roserade, Luxray, Lucario, and Togekiss. The only knock I have against this generation's Pokemon is the starters. I just think they're kind of bland. And this is probably the only game in this series where I have no problem dumping my starter pretty early on. Of course, this is just my opinion, but yeah. Platinum also has a good soundtrack and some nice set pieces. Cyrus, the main villain and leader of Team Galactic, is actually one of the best villains in the series. He's so cold and detached and sociopathic that it actually makes him sort of interesting. Although I can't say the same for the rest of Team Galactic, as they're kind of just Team Rocket, but worse. The region of Sinnoh itself is kind of okay, and the story, like every Pokemon game outside of Generation 5, is nothing to write home about. And, Cynthia is the best champion the series has ever had. So, mostly good, but what keeps me from absolutely loving this game is two things. The first of those is the HMs in this game. Good lord, this game handles this system worse than any other game in the series, and it isn't particularly close. I mean, as if Rock Smash, Cut, and the fact that we have 3 water HMs wasn't bad enough, adding Defog was downright indefensible, especially when, by this point, they had already figured out that they could just make Flash a TM. Why couldn't they do that for Defog? You practically need to have 2 HM dedicated Pokemon just to get through this game, and it's annoying. The other issue I have is just a general issue with the speed at which this game runs. It's not like it's necessarily poor performance per se, the entire game just runs quite deliberately slow, and it's a real pace breaker. And no, I didn't just get used to it as I played. I couldn't help but think the entire time that I played the game that even the Game Boy games ran faster than this did, and they didn't have a run button. This problem persists in battles too, where health bars drain at a snail's pace. The overall sluggish nature could absolutely be a greater indictment against the game in other people's minds, and I'm not going to say I'm willing to give it a pass. But it doesn't quite ruin the game for me either. It's just, much like the HMs, kind of annoying. All of that said though, I'm still glad I went back and gave this generation one more shot. I know it's a lot of people's favorite because it was the first Pokemon game for the best-selling Nintendo system of all time, the Nintendo DS. A lot of people have a ton of nostalgia for these games, and I can see the merits through my non-bias, much like I can see how people don't love Generation 3 as much as I do with all of my biases. As far as all the generations go, this sits somewhere in the middle for me, and I'm gonna give it an 8 out of 10. The fifth game in 2021 that I beat was Brutal Legend on the PlayStation 3. This is a beat-em-up slash strategy slash action slash adventure game from the minds of Tim Schafer and Double Fine, the creators of Psychonauts. It also comes from the voices of Jack Black, Tim Curry, Lemmy, Ozzy Osbourne, Lita Ford, and a whole lot more. This game is, if you couldn't tell from all those names, one giant tribute to metal music. And as somewhat of a metalhead myself, I couldn't have possibly been more enticed by the concept alone. Just in case you didn't know, I love metal music. Now, my tastes are a bit outside of the usual demographic, since I'm more into the power metal, symphonic metal, doom metal, progressive metal, and folk metal, but I still love the metal culture, because in case you aren't aware of this, metal music as a whole is, for the most part, absolutely loaded with camp. It's not meant to be taken super seriously, at least not most of it. For a lot of people, it simply exists as a form of expression, as a way of having tons of fun, because a lot of metal music is just that, fun. It's loud, it's raucous, it's entertaining, and it's certifiably badass. And what's so great about all those descriptors is, at least as far as the setting and tone goes, I can use those exact same words to describe Brutal Legend. This is just a hilarious, ridiculous, and cheesy game that anyone with a sense of humor can enjoy. The story, the dialogue, the premise, the visuals, they are all just a riot. And this game revels in that. It wants you to have fun. And insofar as the gameplay is concerned, most of the time it holds true to that. Just not all of the time. Easily my biggest problem with this game is how dated some of the aspects are. While this game did come out smack dab in the middle of the Xbox 360 and PS3 lifespan, it kind of just plays and feels like a PS2 game, if that makes sense. Its controls are a little bit floaty and wonky, it's got that bizarre old arcadey feel to it that we just don't see in 3D action games anymore, and haven't for quite some time. It doesn't quite have the weight and feel of its characters down particularly well, and as a result it just kind of feels outdated. There are also a few things here and there, especially within the dialogue, that also haven't stood the test of time particularly well, and I won't go into any of that for the sake of spoilers, and spending half this review just setting up context, but you'll know what I'm talking about when you see it. The game can just be a bit tasteless at times, but I also think that can be part of the charm depending on your point of view. It's just such balls-to-the-wall silliness mixed with stupidity already that I don't think most people would really care either way. Now, I want to harken back to when I said before that this game has elements of strategy to it. The way that this particular part of the game is handled is probably its worst aspect. It tries to incorporate sort of an RTS-style component to portions of its gameplay, and those moments just, I mean, they really don't work. Luckily, it doesn't happen too often, but it's definitely the weakest part of Brutal Legend. I have to say that, upon further reflection, if the concept here wasn't so good and the writing and dialogue and the voice acting weren't so terribly clever, this would be an aggressively average game, but those elements are what makes this game. It's what pushes it higher for me. There were just too many moments that had me in stitches that I can't say I didn't really enjoy it. Brutal Legend it's fun. It's very fun. It's not some masterpiece or hidden gem, but it's one that I have to recommend it to you if you have any sense of humor whatsoever, and I'm going to give it a 7 out of 10. The last game in this video that I want to talk about is one that's probably going to get me beheaded for literal heresy, but it's one that I feel I need to address regardless for the sake of transparency, and that game is Hades for the Nintendo Switch. To start, I just want to say right off the bat that roguelikes are, for me, a genre that never really stick. I often find myself quite bored with and frustrated by even the best games in the genre, such as The Binding of Isaac, Spelunky, or Darkest Dungeon. There are a few others that I've tried, such as Rogue Legacy, and honestly none of them have been all that appealing, because of the very nature of what makes games a roguelike. Procedural generation and permadeath are mechanics I rarely like in any game, especially the former, and the latter I found myself actually intrigued by in only a couple of instances. It's also the really slow plotting progression that most of these games have that, while often enough it's still very tangible, it isn't enough. Roguelikes are a type of game that I rarely feel myself actively getting better at because I never feel like I have the time to learn anything when each and every run is completely different from the last. They just don't appeal to me. They never have. Now, there are, of course, two major standouts in the roguelike genre that have definitely gotten somehow even more praise than anything else I've mentioned so far, if you can believe it. The first of these is Dead Cells, which I do own and I have not yet played. That game won multiple Game of the Year awards and was lauded from the very moment it hit early access all the way up to its release and is still praised to heaven and back. I intend to give it a fair shake someday, but the second game is the one I got around to first instead, and that is of course the game I'm talking about now, Hades. Listen, sometimes even if you universally dislike a genre, you can be compelled to try out something that everybody and their dog is salivating over. Hades is the fourth game by universally appraised studio Supergiant Games. Going into Hades, they already had a great track record. I mean, okay, not everybody really liked Pyre all that much, but I think it's safe to say that both Bastion and Transistor are nothing if not beloved by most of the people who've played them. I have not, or at least not much. I played a couple of hours of Bastion, and that's really it. But I decided to give Hades that fair shake anyway, and man, do I want to love this game. I want to love it so badly. I really and truly do. But this is one of those instances where I have to tell you why this game that I do not see really anything wrong with is also a game that I don't like very much. If you came here to listen to me gush like everybody else already has, I'm sorry, but I'm afraid I can't do that. Are there things about this game I loved? Absolutely. In fact, I can safely say that I love everything about this game, except for the part where I actually have to play it. From the visuals, to the storytelling, to the excellent dialogue, to the absolutely magnificent voice acting, to the character design, and world building. All of these things are just on another level. Supergiant has always been good at crafting visually and aesthetically arresting worlds. And with Hades, they are absolutely at their best. My favorite moment in this game was simply walking around the Temple of Styx and listening to these characters converse with each other. I mean, I relished these moments to the point of actually sitting down and listening to a long play that covered all these conversations just so I could enjoy the characters. But that is not the game part of Hades, and the game part is the part I just couldn't get hooked on. Despite how well implemented the progression is, despite how honestly forgiving the game is in spite of its excellently crafted difficulty, despite how clearly visualized and uncluttered the action itself is, I just don't like isometric combat. Diablo? I didn't play it growing up. I don't have a soft spot for these sorts of games. They don't appeal to me. I can see it. I mean, I really can. I can see everything about this game that people love and adore so much, and I want to like it as much as they do. But what is a game meant to be in the end if not fun? And what am I supposed to do if I'm not having that fun? I can press on, but what's even the point then? Do I just endure it and begin to resent it the more I play? Were the 10 hours I spent on it not enough, or do I need to play more? Obviously, these are difficult questions, and this is a moment where I'm so glad I don't write reviews as a job, because I would absolutely be lambasted over this, even though it's just an opinion. But I am not the person to come to if you want to be told that Hades is a masterpiece. You are spoiled for choice if you're looking for that kind of positive affirmation, I promise you. I just can't be dishonest. I can only be fair, and therefore, since I did not finish this game, I won't score it. But I had to at the very least be transparent, because this game is in fact a triumph and it deserves that much. I'm just one of the few who can't appreciate it quite as much as it should be appreciated. Well, I hope that was okay. This was obviously only the second episode, but so far I'm liking this format, and I may expand it to encompass other things outside of the backlog project because, technically I could make hundreds of videos this way thanks to all the other games I've beaten in my life that I have no intention to ever let's play, so, yeah, food for thought. Anyways, I'll see you guys in the next one.